He didn't seem to show any remorse at all, other than the fact that he was caught.
Upon his confession in the courtroom, he was convicted by a jury of his peers. He was sentenced to death.
He was sent to the death row in the Ohio prison system.
Everybody was happy. It was wrapped up in a bow for a while.
The Ohio Penitentiary was located in downtown Columbus, and that is where Lester Eubanks was confined on his conviction from Richland County.
I knew Lester Eubanks. I didn't go around him. I wasn't afraid of him. It's just I didn't like him. I didn't know what he was in there for except murder. Lester was a tall guy, very cocky, very opinionated. Lester had an attitude. There's a lot of people he didn't like, a lot of things he didn't like. He was basically a loner, painting or writing or doing whatever he'd done, you know.
Eubanks was allowed to have paintbrushes and canvases. That was not unusual for any prisoner on death row in the 60s and 70s to be able to utilize whatever skills they had. They were able to eat their time doing something constructive. Three separate times, his execution was pushed back for unknown reasons. And then finally, he was pushed because 1972, the death penalty was abolished.
The United States Supreme Court in 1972 found that the death penalty was administered in an arbitrary and capricious method. So Eubanks, along with other Ohio death row prisoners, had to have their sentence set aside, and it reverted to a life sentence.
I was angry. I was angry and shocked and confused. But if you can't do anything about some things, you have to let it go. That's what we did. We went on with our lives, knowing that he was in prison.
After the death penalty was abolished, Lester Eubanks was put into general population.
He could put on a facade, you know, where he looks like a good guy, but he's not.
He is a smooth talker, and he won the guards over. And there's no other reasonable explanation than that. They allowed him to go into this honor program.
At the time, there was a national reform kind of movement to do things in a prison with inmates to help them prepare for life on the outside. Eubanks became eligible for this honor or trustee program that allowed him, under certain circumstances, to venture outside the prison. Sometimes they were allowed to drive trucks from prison to prison. Sometimes they were permitted outside in the presence of a guard to go run errands. The rationale was to reward prisoners for good behavior. That would help them both control the population as well as incentivize good conduct.
He was in several art shows where he won awards. You see photographs of him standing there with these people that don't know who he is or what he did.
He was a serial sex offender. Today we know that he's probably one of the last people you'd want to let in that program because of their recidivism rate or ability to reoffend. That was a real bad idea.
As part of this furlough program for prisoners, along with Lester Eubanks, who were permitted to go on a Christmas shopping trip.
Money in hand, and he's in civilian attire. They were given instructions, of course. Hey, you go ahead, do your shopping for your families. You have to report back by 2 p.m.
And rather than staying together as a group, they were permitted to leave the presence of the guard and be on their own, shopping among the public. It was a period of 2 to 3 hours later where they were going to meet at a particular place. And when that time came, Lester Eubanks did not report back to the agreed meeting place.
He avoided the electric chair. He avoided a lifetime in a prison cell. Lester Eubanks was allowed to walk away.
What were they hoping to accomplish with this absurd program of taking up a child murderer to go Christmas shopping and not even having a guard stand beside him the entire time? It just is baffling.